I think we're going to get a little snow this year. What do you think? Somebody had their lights on coming, you know, it's so cold out there this morning. It's colder in here, I think, than it is outside. But welcome this morning. My name is Greg Nicholson. If you're here for the first time, we have an elder-led church here, so we kind of rotate. It's a privilege to be able to share with you this morning, and glad that you're here for Christmas. I know if you grew up in a Christian home, and you probably have memories about Christmas, a favorite Christmas or something, you think back growing up. I know for me, it was always an exciting time. You know, we would go to my grandmother's house, and we'd have presents and lots of food, and just a lot of fun. And I'll tell you one of my most memorable Christmases. I was about 10 or 11 years old, and I lived in Savannah, Georgia, which is kind of the south. My grandmother lived kind of north Georgia in a little town called Cedar Town. A lot of cedar trees there. And we would drive, like I said, every year we'd go up north to my, or up north in the south, to my grandmother's house. It was about a 6-hour drive. So, you know, I'm the middle kid. I have an older brother, have a younger sister. We were in the back of the car, and we had an incredible time. After we exchanged all the gifts, both my grandparents lived in the same town, so we could see them. You know, so it was a lot of fun. We would wait to the last minute to drive back to our house. So it's usually like a Sunday night. We would leave about 6 o'clock after dinner, drive for 6 hours, and get home. And this particular night, we got all our presents and stuff at my grandparents' house. We're driving back, and we're in the back seat back there. You know how brothers and sisters are. And there was this loud boom kind of sound, and my dad looks back. You know, you kids, what are you doing back there? You know, I don't know if you've been a victim of the parent SWAT. You know, we're back there dodging dad. You know, he's driving along 6 hours with three little kids in the back seat. It was always fun. And so we drove on another hour or so, and my dad stops to get gas. He stops to get gas, and he looks on top of the car, and it's like, oh no. He had put all of our toys and suitcases on top of the car before the drive. And they were gone. They were gone. And that bump that we'd heard an hour earlier was those presents and everything. We filled up gas, drove back, and looked all along the side of the highway. Till late in the night, we called the police. We never found our luggage and presents. Isn't that a terrible Christmas? Could it be any worse for a kid to lose all your presents, you know? I don't remember what happened. It was my parents probably got us more presents. It wasn't too bad. But I remember driving along the stretch of highway at 11 o'clock at night looking for our presents, and we never found it. Could it be any worse? I think it could. The first Christmas was terrible. It was terrible. Think about it. Mary, first of all, she's a teenager, and God tells her she's going to have a child. I'm sure everyone could do the math. They figured out, okay, she's pregnant. When did they actually get married? You know, she was probably looked down on in society. And then the government comes in and says, okay, now you've got to go register in your town of birth. So that meant they had to go, you know how far it was from Nazareth to Bethlehem? 90 miles. Okay, 90 miles for us is an hour, you know, maybe. You're driving night. I don't know. Maybe a couple hours. Maybe a couple hours. Yeah, 90 kilometers. 90 miles. So it took them about 7 to 10 days. So here, Mary's 9 months pregnant. She gets on the back of this donkey, and they travel for 90 miles. Oh, can you imagine? Where's Beth? Beth, you know, is Beth going to have a baby here? Can you imagine, you women who've had babies before, it's miserable enough, right? And you would think God is going to bring his son into the earth. You'd think there would be a great welcome for this son of God, right? But then they get all the way to Bethlehem, and what happens? There's no hotels. They can't get a room. So what do? If I was Joseph, I would be really mad. You know, what in the world? Why can't we get a room? I'd be mad at God. For you wives, you know, sometimes you hear about somebody having a baby in a taxi or on the side of the road or in their car on the way to the hospital. And, you know, I'm sure looking back 20 years later, oh, you remember that? That was so funny. But in the moment, it had to be terrible, right? For Mary and Joseph, this had to be a terrible night. And so the worst thing of all, they have to go into like a stable with animals. And she starts to deliver the baby. You talk about a terrible first Christmas. I mean, it couldn't get any worse than that. Why did God do that? Who knows? I want us to look today at this passage of Scripture. I think, you know, we're all familiar with the Christmas story, and I think that it's easy kind of think, well, I know that. I've heard that before. You know, I know the story, how it goes. We've heard it for me 57 years now. But I challenge you to look and to listen to God speak today and from here on out through Christmas. There is so much in this story that's hidden. And part of what I get today is from a book by Tim Keller called Hidden Christmas. I got it at the ICS library. We checked it out. And talks about Mary's faith. And so when I acknowledge that part, I feel like a sermon is like a good song. If you hear a good song, you don't have to write your own sometimes. You want to sing a great song, right? And so I want us to look at the life of Mary today, or just this particular part of her life when the angel appears to her. And I don't know what your Christmas is going to be like. I know for some people, they say it's some of the most depressing times of the year for many people. It's a sad time for some people. They may have lost someone. Some of you would like to be in your home country, to be with your family. I don't know what it's like. You know, there's so many things to do around Christmas. All these parties, all these different things. Women cooking, men cooking, and all these things you have to prepare. You have to go buy presents. You're trying to figure out what your kids will like. You hope your kids will like. Then you feel guilty because you've got enough stuff already, the stuff you're buying, you know. So it is a stressful time. But I think just as we sang Silent Night, I pray that God would calm our hearts to recognize the beauty and the glory, even in what was a really stressful, terrible time for Mary and Joseph. That first Christmas. You know, usually what we come up with are little scenes like this. You know, how cute it must have been, you know, Mary and Joseph in a little stable. I'm sure that was really romantic. And no, it smelled terrible. There they are on that long journey. How cute and fun, adventurous that would have been. No, that was terrible. It was difficult and it was hard. I think what God was maybe saying is, from the very beginning, the road to the cross was not going to be easy. From the very beginning, there's going to be suffering. So I want us to look at this passage in the book of Luke. God gives us a look into Mary's character. I think he's shown us this because she is a model for how we should respond when God asks something of us. She has great faith, great courage to go through what she went through. And I would say that this is where Protestants differ from Catholics on how we view Mary. If you grew up in a Catholic family, for Protestants, we don't see Mary as the mother of God. She was not the mother of God. She was just like us, who was used by God to bring Jesus into the world. And we do not pray to Mary. We don't have to go to Jesus' mother to get to Jesus. We can go directly to Jesus. And so, although she is honored among us all, we do not worship or even pray to Mary. She is an incredible example of a woman who was strong in faith and in courage. So let's look at this passage together. If you've got your Bibles, I want us to read this together. And I like what we did last week. Let's read this out loud together. Would you stand with me, just in honor of God's Word? We'll read this passage from Luke chapter 1. Let's read this together. 1, 2, 3. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying, and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there will be no end." And Mary said to the angel, "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible to God." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be unto me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. You may be seated. Let's pray together. Father God, thank you for your word. God, I thank you for this season. And God, I thank you that even in the middle of what seemed to be a terrible, difficult situation, Father, you were born. That you can show us, even in difficult situations, and probably it is there that it is most obvious that you are with us. We thank you for Emmanuel, that you are with us right now. God, and we pray that you would speak to us. God, we don't need more information. God, we need to obey, to hear your word and to obey. And so, Father, I pray that you would speak to us today, that you would make us more like the Lord Jesus, that we would celebrate what you have done for us this Christmas season. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, if you were hearing this for the first time, this would sound crazy, right? First of all, an angel appears to a person. This would just sound supernatural, right? Some who knows what appears to this girl. And I would say, if one of my daughters came to me and said, "Dad, this angel came to me," Sarah, you know, she's 15 years old. Say Mary is probably in her teens. She came to me, "Dad, I saw this angel." I would be worried about her. "Are you okay? You know, this is pretty crazy." And I think we've read it so many times, we forget how unbelievable this was, that what God had done by showing up and sending an angel to speak to Mary. And so I want us to look at a few things that we can notice in this passage. Because this doesn't happen every day. And if you notice, her response is what I want us to look at. A lot of times we look at what Christmas means, but I want us to look at her response to God and the angels speaking to her. She doesn't just say, "Okay, great, you know, okay, this is great, you know." No, it says, what does it say? It says, but she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. I'm sure she was scared to death. scared to death. She was greatly troubled. It said she tried to discern. So she's trying to figure out the word there for discern means that she was trying to weigh this out. Like, what's going on here? Am I having a dream? Am I hallucinating? What's going on in my head? Like, is this real? Because this is very different. She was trying to discern what was going on and what was happening to her. Can this really be? You know, I think sometimes we think of people back in those days, you know, they didn't have an education. We think, well, they just were very superstitious, kind of accepting of every, you know, believe every kind of little superstitious thing. But no, she was discerning. She was trying to figure out. She was using her mind, not just fearful. But she was fearful, and you notice in Scripture, just about every time an angel shows up, what does the angel have to say? Fear not. Don't be afraid. Because I would be scared to death if some supernatural being... So they always say, don't be afraid. Fear not. And so you see Mary as she listens, trying to discern what's going on. And she just doesn't accept it. She's thinking, she goes, well, how can this be? How can this be, you know, that this is going to happen? She hears what the angel says, but she's questioning, you know. Okay, she understands how a baby is brought into the world, and she understands she's a virgin, so she asks, you know, how can this be that I'm going to have a baby? And I think this is very different. I think sometimes we tell people, well, you just need to believe it. You know, this is what the Bible says. You just need to believe it. But I think questioning with a heart that desires to know truly is a good thing. It's not a bad thing to question. God can handle our questions. And with her saying, how can this be? She really wanted to know. Unlike if you look at Zechariah, just in the same chapter right before that, the angel appears to him and tells him his wife is going to have a baby, and he's very old. He asks almost the exact same question. How can this be? We're really old. But something about the attitude of his question must have been different than Mary's. It must have been of, I don't believe this. I don't want to believe this. But it was very different because the angel said, you have a sign now that you won't be able to talk for the entire pregnancy. And I think there are two different kinds of questions that we have with God. We have questions we genuinely want to know from our heart. Okay, God, this doesn't make sense, but I want to understand you. That is very different than, okay, I don't believe this already. I'm going to shut this conversation down because it can't happen. And I think God weighs the attitude of our heart when he does tell us, and when we have questions. You know, some people become Christians real quick. They have something supernatural. I've seen many ties, you know, here. We pray for they lost their wallet. And they became a Christian. They lost their wallet and they found their wallet. It was kind of a supernatural thing. And they, oh, I believe in God. And I would say that kind of faith, just taking some kind of supernatural thing that happens is often not thought through carefully. And I would say God does want to reach into our hearts and speak to our hearts, but he always goes to our minds as well. He wants to answer our questions about God and what he wants to do. And so allowing others to ask questions about faith is a very good thing. We should never shut them down. Well, the Bible, this is what the Bible says. No, that's a good question. So the angel explains to her how this will happen, that the Holy Spirit would come onto her, a supernatural miracle that God would plant a seed in the womb of this young girl. And if you don't think this is supernatural when you read it, we've lost it, right? You see kids, my youngest daughter the other day said, I love Christmas. I don't know if it's the weather, the presents, but I just love it. And I think for us as adults, sometimes we just kind of lose it. This wonder, this of the miracle that God did in Jesus. We should never lose that. And if we go back and if we read Scripture, we'll see. It truly was a miracle what Jesus did, what God did that day. So the angel answers her, and she doesn't really understand. But I want you to look at her response in verse 38. She says, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." I don't know how long this conversation lasted between her and the angel. It was probably longer than us just reading through it. They can't do a full dialogue of everything. But at the end of the conversation, she said, "Lord, I am your servant. Let it be done according to your will." And this was a big deal. This was a huge deal. What Mary was saying is, okay, I'm willing to take this on, even though I'm just engaged. I know that people are going to wonder about me. You know, I had plans, you know, just like many of you when you get married. Yeah, we're going to get married. We're going to buy this little house. Then we're going to have children. It's going to be, you know, you have your plans for your marriage, right? We all do this. What she was doing is saying, okay, God, I'm going to give it all to you. My life is in your hands. It's your life. I'm sure she was confused. I'm sure she was nervous. I'm sure she was afraid, because this was a life-altering request of God. But she said, God, I'm your servant, and I will let it be done according to your word. Come back to this in a minute, but I want us to go and look at her response. She later goes to meet with her aunt Elizabeth there, who the angel told her was pregnant also. And Elizabeth, when she shows up, it says the baby leapt, is that the word? Leaped in her womb, you know. In her womb, it's like, wow. Elizabeth acknowledged who this child was. And so I want us to read this as well. Mary's response when Elizabeth, after Elizabeth says, "Oh my goodness, such a privilege to have my Lord in my presence here." She came to stay with her aunt there for a while. So let's read this together as well. She says, "And Mary said, my soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has looked on the humble estate of his servant. For behold, from now on generations will call me blessed. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arms. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He helped his servant Israel in remembering of his mercy, and he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his offspring forever. And Mary remained with her about 3 months and returned to her home." And it's a beautiful song. She just breaks out and just, I would love to have just seen her singing to the Lord, just praising God for what God was doing. She's beginning to realize all that God has done for her, is doing in her and through her. And in the focus here, Mary is incredible in her faith, but Mary even brings us back to the real star of Christmas here, right? She's like, wow, look at what God has done for me. Look at what God has done for me. And I love the word she used. She says, my soul magnifies the Lord. It's kind of a weird We don't really say that. Another translation says, my soul, my spirit glorifies the Lord. And you science teachers, you know there's two kinds of instruments. You have a magnifying glass, and you have a telescope, right? They both magnify things. A magnifying glass or a microscope, it will try to make something that's very small bigger so that we can see all the intricacies of a cell or whatever we're looking at, right? Something small that makes bigger. But a telescope, it magnifies in the same way, right? And it's something that's very far away, that's huge, but it looks very small to us. And what a telescope does, you look through a telescope at the moon or a star or a planet that you can see, suddenly you see how big this planet is that looks so small with our natural eye. And this is what Mary is doing. This is what God wants to do with our lives. He wants us to be like a telescope for people who think God is somewhere out there, far away. When they look at your life, when they look at our life, when we look at God, we need to look at God with a telescopic lens and say, God, show me just how big and how great you are. Because we forget, right? We need a different kind of instrument to help us to see how big God really is. She recognizes what God has done for her, and she says, you know, God has recognized me in my humble estate. She's a humble young girl. She says, he has done mighty things for me. He has done mighty things for me. I love that. So magnify, and then the second thing, he has done great things for me. How many of us can say that? That God has done great things for you this Christmas. I think we forget all the great things that God has done. The fact that we woke up this morning, like the video I showed a few weeks ago, just waking up is a miracle. Every day is a miracle. God has given us His Son. He has done, I'm sure every one of us here could tell of something that God has done great in your life that seemed impossible. Right? We have things that God has done in our life. I know this week, we got my daughter, I talk about Joy because she's got this kidney autoimmune disease, and her protein was almost 3,000 when it was here, went down to 2,000 before she left with steroids. And then this week she went to the doctor, it went down to almost 1,000 in her protein. Praise God. We don't know why it did this, but it went down to 1,000. A normal person loses about 120 grams in your every day. 120 grams. She was up to 3,000 almost. Now it went down to 2,000, and thank you for your prayers for her. This is a miracle. Why did it go down to almost 1,000? We're still praying that we continue to get better and better. But God has done great things for me. He brought me to Thailand. He brought me a beautiful wife here. I have 4 children. I have good health. We have so much that we can thank God for. Let us not forget the great things that God has done for us. And most of all, this Christmas, the gift of Jesus. He came down to rescue us. And so Mary, she acknowledges who God is, what He's done. You know, we should all be just amazed at what God has done for us. And if someone says, you know, are you a Christian? We could say, yeah, I'm a Christian, you know. I try to go to church. I try to be a good Christian. I try to read my Bible. If we say it like that, that's more a focus on what we are doing for God. You know, I try to be a good Christian. No, it should be, can you believe God has rescued me? Can you believe that God has saved me from my sin? Yeah, this is hilarious that God saved me. We should be amazed at what God has done in us and through us. And Mary doesn't. She accepts this knowing all that it will cost her and the suffering that she would go through. And I heard someone say, you know, there's a couple of questions you can ask yourself if you want to know how you are in your surrender to God. Is there anything in God's word that He says to you that you know that you wouldn't do? If God says something in His word, is there anything in here that you wouldn't do because maybe you disagree with it or don't like it? Oh, I don't like the way that, I'm not going to do that one. You know, kind of pick and choose the different things. Is there anything in your life that God's word says that you say you wouldn't do? Or is there anything that God could ask of you now to bring into your life, to do in your life, to do through you, that you would say, oh God, I just can't do that. I can't do that. My goodness, that's just too much. And God is extravagant in His love toward us, right? He is extravagant. And He wants us to trust Him in an extravagant way as well. So maybe this Christmas, God is asking something of you. Maybe He's asking you to do something crazy. Just like He asked Mary, would you take my son in your womb and give birth to this child? That is crazy. Maybe God's asking you something today that He wants you to do that seems crazy. It may be He wants you to give someone some money. Somebody that needs money. Maybe He wants you to give an offering, a charity or something. Something just crazy amount that you thought, oh my goodness, that's just kind of way out of my budget. I can't do that. In the church that sent us over many years ago, I'll never forget this. This lady got up in church and it was kind of the building fundraising time of the year for the we were building a new church building, and she got up and shared her testimony. A very wealthy lady. Her husband had bought her a beautiful engagement ring that was huge. It's like a carrot or something. It was crazy. It was very expensive. And she had worn it for many years, very proud of it, she said. And she said, in tears, she said, I don't know why, but God wants me to sell my ring. Give the proceeds to the building of His church here. And she gave it away. Wow. That's extravagant. Extravagant love. I would say whenever God wants to do something in us or through us or ask of something that just seems impossible, we just need to remember the words of the angel that said, with God, nothing is impossible. It may be God's asking you to forgive someone that's hurt you. I just talked to a Thai girl this week who said, yeah, I grew up in a kind of an area of town with a lot of prostitutes and stuff. And she said, my mom just left me with someone and I was sexually abused. And she said, after I came to know the Lord, God really put on my heart to go and forgive this person. So I went to them and forgave them. I thought, wow, that's extravagant grace, right? And forgiveness that she could ask from someone. What is God asking you to do this Christmas to demonstrate His extravagant love, to magnify all that God is in you and through you? I think about the words that we sing, O little town of Bethlehem, says, cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. Do you see that? In the same way, in a real way, just as Jesus came into Mary's womb, God desires to come into our life, to give us life, to rescue us, to save us from our sin. He would enter in. I love the song. Let every heart prepare him room. That's what God wants to do. He wants to be born in you and I today and every day, that we would demonstrate this love of his he has for the world. Be born in us today. You know, you look at Mary's life, and I think it's a lot easier for us now. She didn't have all that we have to look back now and we say, oh, that's how it happened. And then, yeah, Jesus was suffered, but he rose again. I mean, but look at Mary, who is this common person, and the whole world knows Mary, right? Because she simply humbled herself and said, God, yes, you can come into my womb and be born in me today. I do believe if we humble ourselves before God, ask him to come in, he will do more than we can ask or imagine. Mary didn't know. She had no idea what God was doing, right? She had no idea what it was going to be like. We can look back at it and see the incredible miracle that Jesus did. And right now, wherever you are, you can't see how it's going to play out. But God has given us this testimony of his word that we can trust him. And so whether it's God asking you to do something extravagant today, to give extravagant forgiveness, to give an incredible gift to someone that you know needs it, he wants to bless you and to honor you by showing his power and his strength in you, through you. One of the things that we can do is that we can invite people to know who Jesus is, this great news, and how we should respond to it. And so I brought these. We used them last year. We're doing it on the Thai side as well. These Operation Andrew cards, these where you list out 10 people's names that you know. In 2 weeks from now, we're going to have an evangelistic service here. I hope that you'll just bring someone, a friend, a foreigner, a Thai. This is the easiest time of the whole year to tell someone about Jesus, right? Maybe you can just write down, maybe you don't have 9, I've just got 5. But you can write it down in these next 2 weeks. Pray every day. It tells, you know, pray for them. Try to share with them. You know, the first century church grew not because of preachers or evangelistic events. It grew because individual Christians were sharing their faith. They were sharing their faith. A lot of times people were persecuted. They couldn't have big celebrations like we have. God wants to use you in the life of another person. So I want to pass these around, and there's some English ones and some Thai ones that you can take, whichever one you want. And if you want to take one, you don't have to take one. If you don't feel led to, that's okay. But I want you to think through this and just ask God, you know, who can I share with? Who can I bring to this Christmas service? It's so easy. They would love to come and find out what Christmas is about. Celebrate what God has done. It's so sad to me sometimes walking through the malls and you hear these Christmas songs all in English, right? And you know that 90% of the people, 99% of the people in the mall have no idea what's being said. No idea. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. So as you walk through the malls, pray for Thailand. As you walk through your neighborhood, pray. pray for your neighbors, the people you work with, and invite them in 2 weeks. And then God will use you to do something that you thought was not possible. So I want to end today with a song that many of us know, because Mary didn't know all that God would do through her and in her. But we now know. We may not know personally what God's going to do through your individual situation, but I want you to think about that as I sing this song, Mary, Did You Know? This incredible example of courage and of faith of a young teenage girl, God, who would dare to say yes to what you ask her to do. That would alter her entire life. That would bring great suffering and yet at the same time great honor. So God, we pray that just as Mary said, I'm your servant. May it be according to your word. God, we hear the words of Jesus saying that in the garden before he was crucified. Not your will, not my will, but yours be done. And so, God, I pray that we would say those same words today in what you are asking of us, whatever it is, Father, that we could again experience the joy, the wonder, the miracle of Christmas as you are born in us each day, that as your word takes on flesh and blood in our bodies, your word would become flesh in us. God, we thank you for this great privilege. We ask that you would shine your light through us. Thank you for Christmas. Thank you for the Lord Jesus and your great rescue mission to save people for yourself, for your glory, and for your honor. In Jesus' name we pray.